सर मैं आपका ये देख रहा था सर, सीवी सर, इट्स अमेजिंग सर, वेरी रेयर सर,
45 इयर्स इन द फॉरेस्ट
सर. मतलब फिर भी सर एक आदमी जो है, मतलब इट इज वेरी यू नो डिफिकल्ट टू अचीव दीस थिंग्स इन लाइफ टाइम सर. सब ठीक है सर.
How many people you are expecting?
Sir, around 50, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. At least 50 should be there, sir.
Yeah. All students.
Yes, sir. As we are making it YouTube live streaming, sir. Mm-hmm. People can watch now and later also it will be there, and later also people can sir go yeah. through this one, sir. Yes, sir. Yes. MS sir banda system name sir
and call me sir
ha phone mabdi ಹಾಗಾದ್ರೆ ಶುರು ಮಾಡೋದಾ? ಗುಡ್ ಮಾರ್ನಿಂಗ್ ಎವ್ರಿ ಒನ್. As a part of, you know, 75th years of Indian independence, Government of India is, you know, directed to create awareness about 75 species through Indian zoos. So as a part of this campaign as such, we have been given awareness program on, you know, three species. One is Mysore slender loris and Nilgiri langur, and third one is grey wolf. Apart from this, we also be having, you know, some competitions, so that this entire event will be of 1 week program as such. So this is the first day of our this eve as such. I would request our member secretary Zoo Authority Karnataka, Shri Ravi BP sir, to inaugurate this program as such through his, you know, by sharing his views on, you know, our celebration as such, and also our you know, flagship species of the week, that is this slender loris. So over to you, sir. And before that, I would formally welcome Shri Ravi BP sir to this program. And also, we have a very eminent scientist and professor with us, Shri Mewa Singh sir. You are also welcome to this program, sir. And welcome all. Now I would request Ravi sir to address the gathering, sir.
Thanks, Ajit. So thank you, sir, Mewa Singh sir, for joining this job. ಇನ್ ಯಾರಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಅಜಿತ್ ಮೀಟಿಂಗ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ? ನಾವು ಇದೆ ಜನ ಅಂತ ಕಾಣುತ್ತೆ
ಸರ್. ಇದು ಯೂಟ್ಯೂಬ್ ಆನ್ಲೈನ್ ಇರುತ್ತೆ ಸರ್. ಯೂಟ್ಯೂಬ್ ಆನ್ಲೈನ್ ಇರೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಸರ್, ಅಲ್ಲಿಯೂ ಸಹ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಈ ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಜಾಯ್ನ್ ಆಗದಾಗೇನೆ ಸರ್, ಅಲ್ಲೂ ಸಹ ಜನರು ಅದನ್ನ ನೋಡ್ತಾ ಇರ್ತಾರೆ ಸರ್.
ಸೊ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ಸ್ ಟು ಸಿಜೆಟಿ ಅಂಡ್ ಮೈಸೂರ್ ಜೂ ಆಪರ್ಚುನಿಟಿ ಫಾರ್ ದಿ ಸ್ಪೆಷಲಿ ದಿ ಸ್ಕೂಲ್ ಗೋಯಿಂಗ್ ಚಿಲ್ಡ್ರನ್. ಅಂಡ್ ಮೈಸೂರ್ ಜೂ ರೈಟ್ಲಿ ಐಡೆಂಟಿಫೈಡ್ ದಿ ವೆರಿ ಎಮಿನೆಂಟ್ ರಿಸೋರ್ಸ್ ಪರ್ಸನ್ Mayor Singh sir, and he's a sort of a pioneer and an expert in these primates. And I would like to share one of these, actually the my field visit slides. Sneha, can you make presentation? Only three slides are there. What happened, actually I visited Chitradurga and Abbi Zoo while returning back in Kunigal Taluk. I just stopped my vehicle and actually there was a catchy. We first go to this school, public school, the last present night. I was returning from this Chitradurga to my headquarters back, and I saw that actually in a road in a government school. Go to this actually the government public school, the fourth slide. Naya?
Sir.
Rajani? Go to the fourth slide. Sneha?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, no need of.
Sir, is this the right slide, sir?
Is the right slide. Then, expand madi.
Sir.
ನಾನು ವಾಪಸ್ ಬರ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೆ. ಮಕ್ಕಳು ಬೇರೆಯವರೆಲ್ಲ ಕೇಳ್ತಾ ಇರ್ಬೋದು ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಮೀಟಿಂಗ್ ನಲ್ಲಿ ಏನಾಗ್ತಿತ್ತು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ, ದಾರಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಇದು ಸ್ಕೂಲ್ದು ಕಾಂಪೌಂಡ್ ನೋಡಿದೆ. ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ಸ್ಕೂಲ್ ಅಂತ ಇತ್ತು. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಕೆಳಗಡೆ ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ಕಾಡು ಪಾಪ ಸ್ಲೆಂಡರ್ ಲೋರಿಸ್ದು ಒಂದು ಚಿತ್ರನ ಗೋಡೆನಲ್ಲಿ ಬರೆದಿದ್ರು. ಅದರಿಂದ ಒಂದ್ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಬ್ಲೋಪ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಅಮ್ಮ, ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೈನ್ ಮಾಡಿ. ಸ್ಟಕ್ ಆಗ್ತಿದೆಯಮ್ಮ. ನೋ ಇಶ್ಯೂ. ಇದು ಚಿತ್ರ ನೋಡಿದಾಗ ನಾನು ನಮ್ಮ ಡ್ರೈವರ್ಗೆ ಹೇಳಿದೆ, ಕಾರ್ ನಿಲ್ಸಪ್ಪ ನೋಡೋಣ ಏನು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ಹೋದೆ. ದೆನ್ ಗೋ ಟು ದಿ ಸೆಕೆಂಡ್ ಸ್ಲೈಡ್ ಅಮ್ಮ. ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಒಂದು ಅಂಡ್ ವೆರಿ ಇನೋವೇಟಿವ್ ಐಡಿಯಾ ಆಫ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ದಿ ಕನ್ಸರ್ವೇಶನ್. ಈ ಕನ್ಸರ್ವೇಶನ್ಗೆ ಡ್ರೈವ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರದು ದಿ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಬೋಶ್ ಕಂಪನಿ. ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಐಡೆಂಟಿಫೈಡ್ ವಿತ್ ದಿ ಕನ್ಸರ್ವೇಶನ್ ಪ್ರಾಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್ ಸ್ಲೆಂಡರ್ ಲೋರಿಸ್. ಐ ವಾಸ್ ಇನ್ಫ್ಯಾಕ್ಟ್ ಸ್ಟನ್ಡ್. ಅಲ್ಲ, ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಎ ರಿಮೋಟ್ ವಿಲೇಜ್ ಇನ್ ಎನ್ ರೂಟ್ ಇನ್ ಹೈವೇ ಅಂಡ್ ಎ ಗೌರ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಸ್ಕೂಲ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದ ಎಂಟೈರ್ ವಿಲೇಜ್ ಇಸ್ ಐಡೆಂಟಿಫೈಡ್ ವಿತ್ ದಿಸ್ ಪರ್ಟಿಕ್ಯುಲರ್ ಸ್ಪೀಸೀಸ್ ಸ್ಲೆಂಡರ್ ಲೋರಿಸ್. ಅಂಡ್ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ಲಿ ಐ ಟುಕ್ ದಿ ಸ್ಲೈಡ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್ the score. Say that what actually they have written there in the this one. Go to this another slide, Amma.
Yes, sir. 1 minute, sir.
And very interesting. I spoke to a couple of the children and also the school masters. And where the observations are actually the very point blank. They say that actually our habitat is getting changed. Earlier the farmers used to have the pens. It is in a vegetative pens, natural pens. The people allowed to grow the different type of the climbers, including this acacia and acacia concina, different climbers, all those things. But go to the next slide, Amma. Yeah. So this was the actually there in the board. They said the splendor glories. They say card papa undu nirapodavi nishachari anjuburaka sankocha prani. ಇದು ಹಾನಿಕಾರಕ ಕೀಟಗಳು ಕಳೆ ಬೀಜಗಳನ್ನು ಇರಿಗಳನ್ನು ತಿನ್ನುತ್ತದೆ ರೈತ ಮಿತ್ರನಾಗಿದೆ ಹಾಗೂ ಪರಿಸರ ಸಮತೋಲನಕ್ಕೆ ಸಹಕರಿಸುತ್ತದೆ ಈ ಜೀವಿಗಳು ನಾಗವಲ್ಲಿ ಸುತ್ತಮುತ್ತಲಿನ ಮರ ಪಟರೆ ಪದರು ಬಿದಿರು ಮತ್ತು ಸೀಗೆಯ ಮಳೆಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಕಾಣಸಿಗುತ್ತವೆ ಪ್ರಸ್ತುತ ಇವುಗಳ ಸಂತತಿ ರಚಿಸುತ್ತದೆ ಈ ಅಪರೂಪದ ಜೀವಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಗ್ರಾಮದ ಎಮ್ಮೆ ಸಿ ದೇ ಸೇ ದಟ್ ದೇ ಆರ್ ಪ್ರೌಡ್ ಆಫ್ ದಟ್ ಅನಿಮಲ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಯಾವುದೇ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿಗೆ ಇವುಗಳು ಅಥವಾ ಇವುಗಳ ಅವಸ್ಥಾನಕ್ಕೆ ತೊಂದರೆ ಮಾಡಿದರೆ ಗ್ರಾಮಸ್ಥರು ಶಿಕ್ಷಿಸುತ್ತಾರೆ ದಿ ಎಂಟೈರ್ ವಿಲೇಜ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟೇಕನ್ ಅ ಪ್ಲೇಟ್ ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಸಮಡಿ ದೇ ಫೌಂಡ್ ದಟ್ ದೇ ಆರ್ ಡ್ಯಾಮೇಜಿಂಗ್ ದಿಸ್ ಹ್ಯಾಬಿಟೇಟ್ ಆರ್ ಅನಿಮಲ್ ದೇ ಆರ್ ಗೋಯಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಪೆನಲೈಸ್ ದಿಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ದೇ ಸೇ ದಟ್ ದಿಸ್ ಈಸ್ ಇನ್ಕ್ಲೂಡೆಡ್ ಅಂಡರ್ ದಿ ವೈಲ್ಡ್ ಲೈಫ್ ಆಕ್ಟ್ 1972 ಅಂಡರ್ ಶೆಡ್ಯೂಲ್ 1 ಅಪೆಂಡಿಕ್ಸ್ 2 ಪ್ರಕಾರ ಇದು ಇಸ್ ಎ ಸಂರಕ್ಷಿತ ಪ್ರಾಣಿ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಎ ಪ್ರೊಟೆಕ್ಟೆಡ್ ಸ್ಪೀಸೀಸ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ದೇ ಆರ್ ಗಿವನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಮಾಹಿತಿ ವನ್ಯಜೀವಿ ಜಾಗೃತಿ ನಿಸರ್ಗ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆ ಇದರಿಂದ ಒನ್ ಎನ್ ಜಿ ಓ ದಟ್ ಡಿಸ್ಪ್ಲೇಡ್ ದಿಸ್ ಬೋರ್ಡ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಪ್ರಕಟಣೆ ಕಾಡಪಾಪ ನೇಚರ್ ಕ್ಲಬ್ ದೇ ಸೇ ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಸ್ಪೆಂಡರ್ ಲೋರಿಸ್ ನೇಚರ್ ಕ್ಲಬ್ ಪದವಿ ಪೂರ್ವ ಕಾಲೇಜು ಪ್ರೌಢಶಾಲಾ ವಿಭಾಗ ನಾಗವಳ್ಳಿ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಹೈಸ್ಕೂಲ್ ಕೊಡು ದಿ ಅನದರ್ ಸ್ಲೈಡ್ ಅಮ್ಮ ದಿ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಸ್ಲೈಡ್ ನೌ ಸಮಟೈಮ್ಸ್ ವಿ ಫೀಲ್ ದಟ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ದಿ ಬಿಗ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಟ್ಸ್ ದಿ ಜೂಸ್ ದಿ ಫಾರೆಸ್ಟ್ ಡಿಪಾರ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ like the institutes like Indian Institute of Science or the universities, they are going to conserve the species. But here is in a village where actually a government school, some enlightened teacher identified with particular species and the entire village or community is actually now pledged to protect this single species. Imagine there are so many high schools are there in Karnataka, across the countries. Imagine that even maybe one or two schools in a taluka. There are 175 talukas are there in Karnataka. One school in one village taluka means we can give an awareness or create an awareness or set up a conservation oriented education about 170 species. The right way the Central Zoo Authority upon the direction of the Government of India, they say that this is the 75th year and we have to identify 75 species. These are lesser known species. Actually, I'm happy that actually Mysore Zoo has been given a assignment to focus on the slender lories and this Nilgiri langur and the wool, grey wool. All there are actually these species, they have an important ecological role. Amma first slide ke hoge ma, innan slide ke. So very beautifully they are depicted in this world where adu yen tinnutide and adra aara yenu, adra oota yenu, adu elli irutide yenu annodanna bahala chennage presentation madidare. ಅಲ್ಲಿರೋ ಶಾಲೆ ಮಕ್ಕಳಿಗೆಲ್ಲದೂ ಗೊತ್ತು ಈ ಅನಿಮಲ್ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಅಂಡ್ ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಡೆಫಿನೆಟ್ಲಿ ಓದ್ ದಟ್ ಸಮ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಫಾರೆಸ್ಟ್ ಆಫೀಸರ್ ಮೈಟ್ ನಾಟ್ ಹಾವ್ ಸೀನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಅನಿಮಲ್ ಮೈಟ್ ನಾಟ್ ಹಾವ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಹರ್ಡ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ದಿಸ್ ಅನಿಮಲ್ ಇಸ್ ಅನ್ ಪ್ರೈಮೇಟ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ದೇರ್ ಇನ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಇನ್ ಅನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಅರೌಂಡ್ ಬ್ಯಾಂಗ್ಳೂರ್ ಮೇಬಿ ಇನ್ ದಿ ಮೈಸೂರ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ತುಮಕೂರ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದಿಸ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಡ್ರೈ ಸ್ಪೀಸೀಸ್ ಡ್ರೈ ಈಸ್ಟರ್ನ್ ಗಾಟ್ ಸ್ಪೀಸೀಸ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಇದು ಈ ಸ್ಪೀಸೀಸ್ ಇರ್ತದೆ ಇದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಅವರು ಬಹಳ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಹೇಳಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಸ್ನೇಹ ಕೊಡ್ ದಿ ಅದರ್ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ ಸ್ಲೈಡ್ ಅಮ್ಮ ಆ ಸ್ಲೈಡ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಅವ್ರು ಏನ್ ಹೇಳ್ತಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಅದು ಹುಳ ತಿನ್ನುತ್ತೆ ಆಮೇಲೆ ಬಿದಿರು ಬೇಕು ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಆಮೇಲೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಕೀಟಗಳು ತಿನ್ನುತ್ತೆ ನೈಟ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಆಕ್ಟಿವಿಟಿ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ವೇರ್ ಎವರ್ ದಿ ಸ್ಟ್ರೀಮ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ದೇರ್ ದಿ ಸ್ಟ್ರೀಮ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಕನೆಕ್ಟೆಡ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ದಿ ಟೂ ಆರ್ ತ್ರೀ ವಿಲೇಜಸ್ ವೇರ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ದಿಸ್ ಅನಿಮಲ್ ಯು ಫೈಂಡ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ ರಿಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸಸ್ ದೇರ್ ಇನ್ ದಿ ಬ್ಯಾಂಬೂ ಅಂಡ್ ಅಕೇಶಿಯಾ ನಿಲೋಟಿಕಾ ಸ್ಪೀಸೀಸ್ ಇಸ್ ರಿಕ್ವೈರ್ಡ್ ಸೀಗೆ ಇಸ್ ರಿಕ್ವೈರ್ಡ್ ವೈ ಐ ರೈ ಐ ರೈಟ್ ಆನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಒನ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ there are so many people are actually, you know, associated with the conservation. Probably the forest department and the institutes like us do, you must identify this type of institutes, make a network and keep actually reviewing their the priorities and if possible try to support them. Not necessarily through financial support. Imagine that if we can get a one resource person who is an expert in the slender lorries, visit that particular village and have a dialogue with those villagers and the school children, definitely this is a real conservation. And I'm very happy to share this my experience. And if Sneha, if I already just blown up that flight, and now I take 5-6 minutes and it is enough, because I don't want the people to wait for my eminent speaker, Dr. Mewa Singh Saab. And it is a very right cause. And moreover, we are 75th year and we are having a very difficult times now around, in and around everywhere, is a sort of a despair. But collectively, if you understand the science in a proper way and take preventive measures, all of us will come out of this pandemic. And with these few words, and those who are watching and likely to watch this, the YouTube, and definitely identified with the cause of conservation. Any cause is not a small cause. Probably the people who are not aware of this slender lorries, they think, what is this small animal? How come that actually this particular school is identified? I am really impressed. Imagine that actually this is a project supported by a Bosch. Imagine there are many corporate companies. All the corporate companies have identified the particular species, and you can conserve n number of species. Maybe the Dr. Mewa Singh and the persons like other resource person, if they identify the list of the species where actually our focus is not there, because the government driven focus is different, and the understanding of this basic ecological aspects and the natural habitats understanding requirement is somewhat different. If they identify the list of the species, definitely we take it forward and may not have a priority in my zoo, but definitely we are going to identify. We have the 9 zoos, at least all these 9 zoos. Sir, Bewa Singh sir is there, my Ajit is there. If I identify the 9 species which are not very, very, very important, means not tiger, not elephant, other than this species which are focused, if you give me the target of the 9 species, 9 zoos are there, we say this 9 species you must identify at one particular school, take it forward with the 9 resource persons. And you see, they very beautifully they have written, Nana Nele, Nana Intintini, Nana Nuta Martini, Nana Yelista, Yenu Nadana, Animal Yelidanga, Avas and Teddy. This is actually taken by this, the companies which supported this one. And very good. And this type of the posters, you can do it. And Ajita, you can also take a couple of the schools and visit, let your education officer visit regularly and try to identify the conservation cause.
Yes,
sir. These words, I must congratulate the CJ and the JDAK to take it forward, this idea of the conservation to the villages. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
Sir, thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for your kind words and also sharing your field experience with the audience. Next section is by Dr. Mewa Singh. Before we actually head to his presentation as such, I must give brief introduction about Dr. Mewa Singh. It is very motivating, and after going through sir's CV, I couldn't believe that, you know, one could do so much in his one's lifetime. Now, to brief about his CV, sir has done his PhD from University of Mysore, and he has done, you know, training with Smithsonian Institute, and he has been a Fulbright scholar in residence at Bucknell University, and he has been teaching assistant with the Smithsonian Institution, visiting fellow at Geological Society of San Diego, a visiting fellow at German Primate Center, and a summer professor in Germany, visiting lecturer in Malaysia, and visiting professor at the Russian Academy of Sciences, Moscow. Sir worked in forests of Himalaya, Western Ghat, Eastern Ghat, and also in Nicobar Islands. Sir has published more than 200 research papers in leading journals of India and outside, and he has been elected the fellow of Indian Academy of Sciences, Bangalore, Indian National Science Academy, New Delhi, the National Academy of Sciences in Sciences India, Allahabad, and the National Academy of Psychology, India. Sir also been a recipient of Ramana Fellowship by the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India twice. You've been a twice recipient of Ramana Fellowship, and you've also been a recipient of J.C. Bose National Fellowship. And presently, sir, is recipient of the Science and Engineering Research Board Distinguished Fellowship. And sir has also been a winner of Sundarlal Vora Medal in Life Sciences by the Indian National Science Academy, New Delhi, and Golden Jubilee Science Award of University of Mysore. Yes, in sir's honor, some biologists have named the recently discovered new species of frog from Western Ghats as Nyctipectrachus mevasingai. So otherwise, you can call it the Mevasing's night frog. It's very odd, sir. Your contribution for research been tremendous, especially in understanding primates. It's been a breakthrough sort of research in our country as such. And sir B is a chief editor of a journal named Dialogue, Science, Scientists and Society, published by the Indian Academy of Science, Bangalore. And sir is a distinguished professor for life of Mysore University. And sir is also guiding us in our lion-tailed macaque conservation breeding program of Mysore Zoo. And sir has been always, my experience been with sir that, he is always ready to help and guide and ready to share his knowledge. So that is very rare to find off late. We are really thankful to you, sir, and we are really fortunate to have you in today's session. I would request sir to take over and present on Nilgiri Langur. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Ajit, and thank you, Ravi. It's really a privilege to speak, and thank you for the invite. Good morning, everybody. Can I start with my presentation now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Is it visible?
Yes.
Not it, sir. Not it, sir.
Yes, sir. It's
visible. Visible? Yes, sir. Yes, it has come, sir. It has come, sir.
Okay, now, is it the whole screen filled or?
Whole screen, but again, no? Yes, sir. It is coming, sir. Allah, sir's presentation. Sir, it to be, sir. Presentation is not visible, sir. Visible it, sir. Not visible it.
Not visible now?
Yes, sir. No, sir. Not it, sir. You need to share it, seems, sir.
That's what I was doing. Present now. Okay. Share.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
It only says cancel.
ये मतलब पेड़
सर व्हाट हाइलाइटिंग शेयर इट्स शेयरिंग
सर व्हाट यू डू इज सर यू ओपन योर प्रेजेंटेशन सर
ओके नाउ इट्स इज इट
यस नाउ इट शुड बी सर नाउ यस इट शुड कम सर यस सर नो नो सर यू आर प्रेजेंटिंग टू एवरीवन इट यस सर नाउ इट इज कमिंग सर
इज इट विजिबल नाउ
Yes, sir. Now it is visible, sir.
Is it half screen visible or full screen visible or?
Sir, it is not a full. It is visible, sir. Yes, full screen now, sir. Full screen now.
Okay. Yes, so can I start now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And am I also audible properly?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You are audible.
Because sometimes
sir.
It happens that somebody goes on speaking, but.
Yes, sir. Yes.
You know, if there is some problem in between, Ajit, let me know.
Yes, sir, we'll let you know.
So that we simply don't go just one way.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Good morning, everybody, once again. And what I would do is I would speak for about 40-45 minutes. And then we will have discussion, probably some time for discussion. And even if the time is not enough, I have given my email here. And people can write to me after the talk also, and I am quite prompt in responding to emails. So let us start with this presentation. Considering the two species of apes, but last week CCMB Hyderabad published one paper, and they said no, we don't have two species. Actually, it's only one species of apes. And now, coming from primates to langurs, as I said, we have 8 different species of langurs in India. 4 of them are called Hanuman langurs. I mean, they were earlier called only one species. Then somebody said there are 6 species or 7 species. But the latest taxonomy tells us that there are at least 4 species of Hanuman langurs. and Nilgiri langur, and three of these, the golden langur, cap langur, and Perry's leaf monkey. And this is how they are distributed in the country. You know, these three, the golden langur, the cap langur, and the Perry's leaf monkey, these are distributed only in the forests of northeastern India. And they all belong to the genus Trachypithecus. And all others are Semnopithecus. As I said, four species of Hanuman langurs. One is in Himalayas, which is called Cistaceus. Another is Antilus, which is in the central Indian plains. And another is Hypoleucos, which is in Karnataka and parts of Maharashtra and probably Telangana. Another is called Priam, which is down from Bandipur, Nagarhole, southwards, and the Nilgiri langur. So this is the distribution of the eight species of langurs in India. And let us come from India to the Western Ghats. This is where the Nilgiri langur is. The Western Ghats, as you know, it's a hill system which runs along the west coast, you know, from south to north up to Gujarat. And Western Ghats is not just one ecosystem. Actually, Western Ghats is several kinds of ecosystems. There are several ecotones and several changes in the Western Ghats. Just to put the primate species distribution, I am talking about this now. You look, for example, everybody knows down here is called the Palghat Gap. You know, the Western Ghats are divided into the Palghat Gap south of Palghat and the Western Ghats north of Palghat. And there is also many species distribution. Some of the species distribution ends, you know, the northern distribution at Palghat. So especially the amphibians, I mean, you find them only either south or north of Palghat. And the second or some of these lesser known ecotones is this Brahmagiri Hills in Karnataka. And this is where the distribution of Kulenia axarilata. See, Kulenia axarilata is a keystone species in the rainforests. But Kulenia axarilata is found in very, you know, small portions of Karnataka, but it's found only in Tamil Nadu and Kerala. Its distribution ends here in Brahmagiri. And interestingly, the distribution of Nilgiri langur also ends here. And these here near Makut and Srimangala and these places, these are the northernmost distribution points of Nilgiri langurs. And above that, we have only Hanuman langurs. And if you go further, for example, between just below Agnashini River, here, there is another ecotone change. We have, you know, the end of low to medium altitude dipterocarp forests. And north of this, we don't have these type of forests. And interestingly, here is the northernmost population of the lion-tailed macaques. So what I want to tell you was that in the Western Ghats itself, even the primate distribution, you can see certain ecotones, and those ecotones also mark the distribution of primates. If you look at Karnataka, this is a very interesting state for primate distribution. You see, we have here the northern part. Here you can see the black-footed grey langur. This is Semnopithecus hypoleucos. It starts from somewhere north of Kurg, starts from, you know, Talcaveri and these places further onwards, and in the northern parts of Karnataka, where you can find them in the rainforest as well as in dry patches here all over. But from Nagarhole or something downwards, we have another Hanuman langur, which is called Coromandel Grey langur, which is Semnopithecus Priam. And then you can see a small patch here in Brahmagiri and Makut. These reserve forests here is the distribution of Nilgiri langurs. And Nilgiri langurs are found only from south of this place. This is the northernmost population. So if you see, for example, the distribution of primate species in India, except Assam and Arunachal, where there are eight species, I mean, we can say it sometimes nine, but actually eight species of primates. In the whole country, Karnataka has the largest number of primate species. You know, we have six species of primates. So we have the black-footed grey langur, we have Coromandel grey langur, we have Nilgiri langur. So three species of langurs, then we have bonnet macaques, then we have lion-tailed macaques, and also we have cylinder loris, the only state other than those northeast states where there are six primate species available. Interestingly, cylinder loris, tomorrow Kumara will be talking about that. Even cylinder loris also, we have two subspecies. In the Western Ghats here, in Kurg and upwards, we have the Malabar cylinder loris. And from Bangalore towards Tumkur and all, which Mr. Ravi was just talking about, this is called Mysore cylinder loris. So we have two different subspecies of cylinder loris also in Karnataka. So Karnataka is quite rich in primate distribution. And now Nilgiri Langur, just to put again into perspective, I mean, this is all known to everybody that this is an animal which is a chordate and which is a mammal, belongs to the order primates, and it's Cercopithecidae, which includes all monkeys which are known as the old world monkeys found in Asia and Africa. And the subfamily is Colobines. Colobines are basically the leaf-eating monkey, which is like black and white Colobus, proboscis monkey, and all langurs. And this particular animal belongs to the genus Semnopithecus. It has been earlier called Presbytes, then later on it was called Trachypithecus. But the latest classification is that this is Semnopithecus, and the species is called Semnopithecus johnii. Now, there has been quite a bit of research on Nilgiri langurs. I will not talk about any of these individual people who did the, you know, who did what. I mean, this is just to put in a perspective again that the research started in 1960s. There was a small paper in 1965 by Chanaka on social structure of Nilgiri langurs. Then Poirier was the person actually who did the full-fledged PhD thesis in Nilgiri hills on Nilgiri langurs. This is the first detailed study on Nilgiri langurs. Then Horwitz spent some time, John Oates came, Homan, and Wesley Sundar Raj is another PhD. He worked in Mudanthurai and he did his PhD work. Then Joseph and Ramchandran did some work, and Umapati and Ajit Kumar, they started this big project in Annamalai Hills, and Nilgiri langurs was one of the species which Umapati did for his PhD. And then our group has been working, and several people, for example, Sushma did PhD on not Nilgiri langur alone, but Nilgiri langurs and lighter macaques, and I would come to that work later on. And Kavna did PhD on Nilgiri langurs and Hanuman langurs. So these are the people who have worked on Nilgiri langurs. Now, the outline of my talk is going to be that I'll briefly talk about Nilgiri langur biology, distribution, demography, etc. Then I would talk about Nilgiri langur in relation to other species, because no species exists in isolation. Nilgiri langur is found with other species. How this species behaves and how this species behaves when it is sympatric with other species. Then towards the end, I would talk about the threats to Nilgiri langurs and the conservation of Nilgiri langurs. And in the end, a little bit about Nilgiri langur in captivity also. So this would give an overall perspective about the species. Now, to begin with Nilgiri langur, this is just the distribution here. This we published this last year in the IUCN Red List. And this is, you can see two different subpopulations. One here, you know, down south, then the gap, and then towards Karnataka. It is probably there are about 20,000 individuals and less than 10,000 mature individuals in the wild. And you know that it's found in the Western Ghats, only in the states of Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, and Kerala. It is only in these forests. And this is the distribution that north, as I told you, up to Makut, and south it starts from Aramboli, that is quite down south. And interestingly, it is found in several kinds of forest types. Most of the langur groups are in the rainforest, but you can find them in semi-evergreen forest also, in moist deciduous forest also, in mountain forest also in riparian forest. So it's a bit of a habitat generalist as compared to, say, species like, for example, the lion-tailed macaque of the Western Ghats. And it is seen from 180 meters to up to 2000 meters. No other primate actually is found at that much height. In Himalayas, once again, it is the Hanuman langur which is found, above 2000 meters. And here in the Western Ghats also, the other primates like lion-tailed macaques, bonnet macaques, never go up to that altitude, but the Nilgiri langur goes up to 2000 meters. Now, there are some contiguous habitats, but the most habitats of Nilgiri langurs, like that of the lion-tailed macaque, for example, are severely fragmented. But population, by and large, is stable, you know, as compared to some other species where the population has been steadily declining. There has been some decline over the years, but population is, by and large, stable. Now, just to give you once again, a picture that the density of Nilgiri langur varies as for any other species. For example, say if you see in Srivilliputtur, it's only 0.4 animals per kilometer. Then in Nilgiri South, it's one animal. In Agastyamalai, 1.7. But Annamalai, I would come to this place again and again, because not only my research group, but several groups have done long-term studies on Nilgiri langurs and other primates in Annamalai Hills. I would come to these hills again. But you can see that this is a very, high density of Nilgiri langurs, as much as 6.2 animals per kilometer here, and this is determined by the habitat quality and suitability, how good is the habitat for the species, and also the level of protection, because some of these primates are also hunted, especially the Nilgiri langurs. And some of these biological attributes is to the simple, very simple, you know, it's the male and female body length. The males are slightly larger than the females, and they also weigh slightly more than the females. The tail length is more or less equal. And I just got this information because these animals have been breeding. In the Mysore Zoo, there have been some births, but most of the breeding has actually occurred in Vandalore Zoo. So this morning only, I was talking to Dr. Manimosi in Vandalore Zoo, and he told me that the sexual maturity is between 3 to 4 years, and gestation, this has been between 195 to 185 to 190 days, and the interbirth interval is between 18 to 24 months. So this is information which is obtained from the captive animals in Aranyarana Zoological Park. The demography and ranging, usually they are unimale groups. You know, there are multi-females, there are several females, and unlike, say, for example, bonnet macaques, it is usually one male. You very rarely you see two or three males in one group, unless it is in some fragment or something. But you also see occasional all-male bands. So it is an interesting social organization that you have, a group with several females and one male, and all other males, you know, when they become juvenile sub-adults, they leave, and in the forest, you can see all male bands. This is very much observed in the Hanuman langurs, but also in the Nilgiri langurs. And these animals live in small groups. The groups range from 2 to 29, but the average group size is about 7 to 9 animals. And, in dry forest, the group size are smaller, but in wet forest, they are slightly large. But with this kind of median, about 8 to 9 animals. Now, these home ranges also, Nilgiri langur home ranges are really very small. Although Frank Poirier, in some group, he reported something like 25 hectares in Nilgiri Hills. But in most of the forests, their home ranges are really very, very small, about 2.2 to 6.4 hectares, which is very small. I'll come to that later on because they're basically leaf eaters. And their day range also is very little. I mean, they just don't move much, 112 to 460 meters. And we have several jokes when we were working in Annamalai Hills. And when Sushma was doing her PhD, I had students working on bonnet macaques, on lion-tailed macaques, on Nilgiri langurs, on Hanuman langurs in the same forest. So in the evening, we used to be sitting and talking, and somebody would tell that my bonnet macaque group moved 1,200 meters. Another person saying my lion-tailed macaque group went 1,800 meters. And we would joke that, these Nilgiri langurs move only 60, 70 meters. And Sushma would say, no, today they moved 100 meters. They really don't move much. It's just, sit there and relax. And they're mildly territorial. Now, this is an interesting thing that most primates are not actually territorial. They have what is known as overlapping home ranges. Now, within home ranges also, the other macaque species tolerate each other. But Nilgiri langurs, first of all, their home range is very small. And they have a core area inside the home range, core areas of two groups. Very rarely would overlap, actually would never overlap. But home ranges sometimes overlap. But once the two groups meet in an overlapping home range, they are usually a bit aggressive towards each other. Now that indicates that they are mildly territorial about their ranges. Now this is interesting thing about Nilgiri langurs, time, activity, budgets. Now there are not much seasonal variations, so don't bother about the dry monsoon and post-monsoon season. These are the data from my student Sushma's PhD thesis. Now, if you look at most of the time by Nilgiri langurs is spent in these two activities, that is resting and feeding. The ranging is very little, social behavior is very little. I'll come to these later on. See, these animals feed and then they sleep. What do they feed? I'll come to in the next slides. Why do they have to spend so much time on resting? I remember one of my research scholars, he was working on Nilgiri langurs in the Annamalai Tiger Reserve. And I saw him many times, about 2.5 kilometers on the roadside, there was a tea shop. I saw him sitting on the tea shop and, I had asked him, what are you doing here? Why are you not with your monkeys? And he said, what to do there? They're sleeping all the time. They just spend some time, in feeding, and then they go and sit and they sleep. So they spent most of their time, actually, if you see, no other primates, you won't see the macaques, for example. You know, macaques, lion-tailed macaques, 60-70% of their time, they are moving around, in the searching for food. The other animals would be very busy in social activities and so on. Now, Nilgiri langurs are resting most of the times. Why? Now, this would, I'll come in the next slide. And this is at where, which heights they are. You know, they are usually between 5 to 20 meters in that height, whether you take off the animal height, the height used by the animals or the feeding, which happens, you know, between 5 to 20 meters. Now, this is interesting thing. Most interesting thing about Nilgiri langurs is actually their diet. You see here, for example, most of their diet is leaf. It's about 55% here, you can see, is the leaf. And then fruit and other items like flowers, etc., and petiol and so on. You know, both of these, this is data from, you know, my report there from Annamalai Tiger Reserve. And this is Sushma's PhD thesis and Umapati's work also. But they are basically leaf eaters. And furthermore, it's just not simply leaf. Look at the left side here. Petiol, okay, so all young and mature, but the leaf. You see the leaf which they eat, this is the important thing to see, that they eat flush and young leaf. I mean, 90% or 95% leaf which they eat is flush and young, and whole leaf, which is, you know, mature leaf, for example, is very little. They cannot digest it. So all the leaf, so it's simply not their diet is leaf. It is flush and young leaf. Likewise, fruit, they don't eat much. But whatever fruit they eat, you can see once again, it is unripe fruit. They don't eat ripe fruit, which is only about 8 to 9% of the diet of fruits. Most of the, you know, fruit which they eat is unripe. This has a lot of consequences. I'll come to a little later. The plant species, this is a list. We have a whole list of plant species, which is published by Umapati and Kavna and Sushma, you know, about their, after their PhD work. This is just to tell some of the important species they use for leaves and for fruits and for flowers. This is from several other rainforests, but Kavna also did this work in Nilgiri. She observed the group near Naduvattam in, you know, as a part of her PhD work. This group was interesting, their feeding ecology, that they eat on leaves and sometimes needles of pines. Now, this indicated that sometimes, you know, when there is a scarcity of food as fallback foods, these langurs also can go to non-native plants, or they can go to low-quality food as a fallback food. So now if you look at the speciality of Nilgiri langur diet, I'm going back once again. See, they have enlarged and saturated forced stomach. It's like sacs. Their stomachs are like cow's stomach. And there's a lot of bacterial microflora which ferments this ingested food. And this microflora produces volatile fatty acids. So langurs get all their energy and they can manufacture proteins from leaves. And this is whole, the whole system has adapted to digest leaves. So carbohydrate foods, they can lead to acidosis and they are very harmful. Now this is the big lesson actually to people who keep animals in captivity. You know, if you give, for example, bananas, all primates would love to eat bananas, but banana is a very harm. As I showed you before, leaf also, it is only flush and young leaf, not mature leaf. Fruits also, it is only unripe fruits, not ripe fruits. And fruits, giving like ripe bananas and giving them modern bread. And this is very, very harmful. And that actually is the reason that langurs are very difficult to maintain in captivity. It will come later. See, I have seen in, for example, Duke's langur, when I was working with the Cologne Zoo in Germany, that was the only zoo which was maintaining. Very difficult to maintain, you know, ultimately all animals died. It's very difficult actually to maintain langurs because of their special diet, that they need leaf and unripe fruit. And leaf also be up to a particular level of maturity. You see, when you are in the forest, for example, you would see a very interesting association between Hanuman langurs and spotted deer, axis, and between Nilgiri langur and the deer also, because langurs are so selective about leaf eating. You know, they take the leaf and they test and they take only the soft part and they throw the leaf. So if you are walking in the forest, if you see a lot of leaf fall, you would know that up there are langurs there. And along with that for leaf move, these groups of deer, because langurs keep eating selective parts of leaf and keep on throwing the leaves. and these herds of deer, especially spotted deer, they keep moving along with the langurs because they get free leaves thrown by the langurs. So this has a lot of application for captivity, especially. Now, other thing, birdspeaks, they actually produce more or less throughout the year if you take long-term data, but they have two peaks in May, June, and September and November. It is usually single birth. They are a very, very rare case that they would have twins. Birth rate is about 70%. And there is an interesting behavior in them is when the infant is 3 to 7 weeks, there is a lot of infant transfer between the females. From the mother, the other females, they take the infant, they groom the infant, and then they pass on to another female. This is a typical pattern seen in Hanuman langurs also. In macaques, you usually don't see this. The infant transfer, the movement of infants, among females. And then early weaning starts about 7 to 9 weeks, when females start a little bit of rejection, start encouraging the infants to start eating the hard food. And when the infant is about 14 weeks, the mother starts leaving the infant most of the time. And this is also the time when, interesting behavior takes place in Iriri langurs called babysitting. Some females, when they are foraging somewhere, if there are one or two infants, usually you see one female sitting there and, doing a sort of babysitting. And when the infant is about 10 to 11 months old, there is a complete weaning. The infant becomes totally independent of mother's milk and eats food from the environment. Now, I would talk, most of my talk from now onwards will be in Annamalai Tiger Reserve. That Annamalai ecosystem is a very interesting ecosystem put together. If you see, about more than 3,000 square kilometers, of which includes Annamalai Tiger Reserve, Parambikulam Tiger Reserve, Nelliyampathy Hills, that's where most of our research has been going on for now almost 3 decades, right now also. And this is also a landscape where there's the largest population of Nilgiri langurs. And this region also is a typical representative of the Western Ghats. See, Western Ghats have rainforests, eastern slopes have dry forests, and there are lots of rivers, lots of dams, disturbance due to dams. There are tea and coffee plantations. You can see all of these things in Annamalai Hills ecosystem, yet you can also see extremely rich flora and fauna in these hills. So this is a typical representative, and long-term studies have been carried out in the Annamalai Hills Tiger Reserve. Now this is not the entire Annamalai ecosystem, but only ATR, the Annamalai Tiger Reserve. This is about 840 square kilometers. This is here, this Attakatti, and you see down here, this is the ridge of the Western Ghats. So on the western side are the ridge and the slopes, and now these are patches of rainforests. Once upon a time, these were all extensive rainforests, but about 190 years ago, this tea plantation started in this area called Walpare Plateau. So we have the tea and coffee plantations, patches of the rainforests. So most of the rainfall is up to this ridge and the western slopes, and the eastern slopes, they are a little bit dry forests. So if you start, for example, from the eastern forest side, from Aliyar, this is Aliyar Reservoir. Now, this is about 250, 300 meters from the mean sea level, because this is on the eastern side, this is rain shadow. So you have this typical southern scrub forest. And you go slightly up, you go up about 800, 900 meters, you see these large stretches of deciduous forests. You go further up, about 1,000 meters, 1,200, this almost up to 1,400 meters, you see these vast stretches of rainforests. And then you go to the hilltops, you see these typical, what is known as sholas. Sholas are these hollows, where the topsoil is filled, and you see these vegetation patches on the hilltops. So you see all different kinds of habitat types, and you also have the tea gardens. So in these hills, if you see, for example, the 4 species of diurnal primates, these are the lion-tailed macaques, it's very rare species. And then the bonnet macaque, the Nilgiri langur, and the Hanuman langur. So these 4 species of diurnal primates are found in these hills. But if you see, for example, their distribution patterns, it is very interesting. You see, we have the rainforest, moist forest, and the scrub deciduous forest. The bonnet macaques are largely found in the deciduous and scrub forest. On the other hand, the lion-tailed macaques are all found in the rainforest. Likewise, the Hanuman langur, all of them are found here in the deciduous scrub forest, and the Nilgiri langur are largely found in the rainforest. Also, as I told before, a few groups are also found in the deciduous forest and the dry forests. And you see the altitudes also. The bonnet macaques are up to about 1,000 meters. Lion-tailed macaques, they start from 1,000 meters and go up to 1,500 meters. And Hanuman langur, mostly below 1,000 meters. And Nilgiri langurs start from nearly 1,000 meters. In these hills, around 700, 800 meters, and go almost above 2,000 meters, which is, Akamalai grass hills, where, you don't see other primate species going that high. Now, if you look at the distribution pattern, you would see something very, very interesting here. As I said, these are the eastern slopes. Now, these are dry forests, and you find bonnet macaques and Hanuman langurs. And these are wet forests here. You find lion-tailed macaques and Nilgiri langurs. This tells you a fantastic ecological story that in ecological times, this is how these species would have simply, done their sort of resource selection or habitat selection. You see here, the macaques are basically fruit eaters and langurs are basically leaf eaters. So you see these forests have one fruit eater and one leaf eater. You go to these forests, lion-tailed macaque, fruit eater, and Nilgiri langur, a leaf eater. So in ecological time, this kind of separation has taken place that of the two fruit eaters, one has gone to these dry forests and one is in the wet forest. They avoid competition. The two leaf eaters, one you find here in the dry forest, other you find in the wet forest, and there is no competition. And in a particular forest, you have a fruit eater and a leaf eater. In another forest, you have a fruit eater and a leaf eater. So this is how an ecologist understands the distribution patterns and interprets them, that these are not simple by random distributions. Now, it is not simply randomly distributed. Any animal species, for example, the same way we have seen in Annamalai Tiger Reserve here only, for example, this region, this dry forest, there are more leopards than in the wet forest, but there are also more spotted deer. So smaller predator, smaller prey. In these forests, you have relative abundance of tigers is more, but you also have a high abundance of gaur and sambar. Sambar is a large deer and gaur. So in wet forests here, you have tiger, which is a large predator and large prey. Here you have leopard, which is a smaller predator and smaller prey. So this whole hill system has a fantastic distribution, not only of primates, but also of other species. Now, as I told you, Nilgiri langur, they are found with this was Sushma's PhD work. She spent several years looking at these species now, there in Annamalai Tiger Reserve, Nilgiri langurs, lion-tailed macaques, bonnet macaques, and Indian giant squirrel. There is a particular place where we found all four species together. I'll show you later on that bonnet macaques were not actually there all the time. They were only going occasionally. But for these four species were found together. So the point was to see now how these four species exist together. I mean, there should be solid amount of competition. So Sushma conducted this long-term study. What we do in this kind of study is it's a very, very painstaking study. You first see, for example, which plant parts are eaten by these species. Fruits, leaves, pith, nectar, fruit, leaf, and ripeness. Which level of ripeness, whether it's, fresh or ripe or unripe, which tree, what height the animals are foraging, what substratum for insects they are searching, what are their activity schedules, what a kind of interspecific, whether they are aggressive towards each other or they tolerate each other. And then the phenology, productivity of the forest, all this has to be studied to study the ecology of these species. And then we study what is known as niche breadth. Forget about this equation, etc. But niche breadth simply means is how broad is the food spectrum of a species. Just take an example. Suppose species A feeds on four items. Species B also feeds on the same four items. But in species A, all four items are represented 25%. In the other, the four items, one item is 90%. The other items are small, like chutney. Okay. The niche is broad for the first species because, you know, the all items are almost equally represented in the food, whereas in other these species, it is only one. The others are only very small percentage proportion. So we calculate niche breadth of the species. So this is the niche breadth. You, if you look at these two, for example, forget about this data. I mean, I want to avoid these data tables, but this would make a little bit of better sense if you just show these numbers. Just look at these numbers. You know, the lion-tailed macaques and bonnet macaques have very narrow niches. But Nilgiri langurs and Indian giant squirrel, they have slightly broader food niches than lion-tailed macaques and bonnet macaques. And the next step what we do is known as niche overlap. This is an interesting thing. Niche overlap means, in simple language, how much is the dietary overlap between two species? See, niche breadth is for a single species. Niche overlap is for two species. Now, for example, you have species A, for example, bonnet macaques, let's say Nilgiri langurs and lion-tailed macaques. The niche overlap would be very little because Nilgiri langurs eat leaf and lion-tailed macaques primarily eat fruit. But suppose they both of them eat some fruit, then what we see now is the shared items or common items, which are common in the diet of two species, how much each represents as a percentage in the diet of that particular species. So you go on summing up and you try to, you know, find out, you try to standardize what is known as niche overlap. It's a bit complicated process. So what it tells is that the niche can overlap from 0 to 100. Zero means the diet of two species is totally different. You know, 100% would mean not only that the two species feed on the same items, but the percentage of each of the food items is equal in the diet of the two species, which can never happen. So theoretically, the niche can overlap between two species from 0 to 100. So once we studied this, we found that there was a substantial niche overlap between the lion-tailed macaques and the bonnet macaques. You know, if the niche overlap is more than 0.5, the two species actually have trouble. They would find very difficult to coexist. So the lion-tailed macaques and bonnet macaques, they had very high niche overlap during particular season, post-monsoon. And we realized later on that bonnet macaques actually were not permanent residents of the rainforest. They actually go there for collinear flowers and then they go back to the deciduous forest because the species with that much niche overlap cannot coexist. On the other hand, there was a considerable niche overlap between Nilgiri langur and giant squirrel also, although not more than 0.5, but considerable niche overlap. But as I told you before, the niches were quite broad. Nilgiri langur and giant squirrels had cropped quite broad niches and there was some amount of overlap. On the other hand, these two macaques, they had narrow niches but high overlap. So this tells that these two species cannot coexist, but these two species can. And it's not only this. If you see, for example, foraging height or at what height the animals are, you take, for example, a data over 6 months, over 1 year, you know, what we call the scan sampling. Each time you see the animal, you see where the animal is, at what height, if the animal is foraging. And then you put these thousands and thousands of these records. And then we found out later that if you look at, for example, the moving height or the foraging height in the same forest, the bonnet macaques will be at the top. And then the second story, the little bit story below is this, where you find the lion-tailed macaques, whether it's just for resting and movement or the graph below here for feeding. And then you see the Nilgiri langurs and the giant squirrels. So you see, for example, there is some kind of a vertical separation. It is not only the food that the animals eat, different kinds of foods, but you see in the forest, there is a sort of vertical separation also in their movement and foraging. So this tells us, you know, a bit about the ecology of these species, that the species which have high niche overlap but narrow niche breadth, they cannot coexist on permanent basis, like the lion-tailed macaques and bonnet macaques. The species with high niche overlap but if they have wide niches, they can coexist, like the Nilgiri langurs are coexisting with the giant squirrels. and the species with low niche overlap, regardless of whatever the niche breadth is, they can coexist like the Nilgiri langurs and lion-tailed macaque, because Nilgiri langur is primarily a leaf eater and the lion-tailed macaque is primarily a fruit eater. Now, we also looked at, Kavana, during her PhD, looked at behavioral variability, and Joseph, who did PhD with me on macaques, and they were simply looking at how much is the variability which is indicated by the inter-individual behavioral variability. I'll just quickly talk about this slide, not in detail. You know, what we found is that langurs are less variable than the macaques. Macaques show more variability, whether lion-tailed macaques or bonnet macaques, than the langurs. And between the langurs, actually, Nilgiri langurs show less variability than the Hanuman langurs, which indicates that there is a less within-group competition. Macaques have more within-group competition, and langurs have lesser within-group competition. This is a bit technical thing. I would just leave this here. Now, this is an interesting thing about Nilgiri langurs. Folivory is a constraint on social behavior in Nilgiri langurs. Now, just look at Nilgiri langurs. I won't compare this with the macaques. Macaques are highly social animals. If you look at the diet of Nilgiri langurs and Hanuman langur, say Nilgiri langurs, several studies we have done here, mean values. You know, from our study, from another study, from Ramachandran Joseph, from Roy, and several studies, mean values we have taken. See, Nilgiri langurs, the diet is, as I told you before, is primarily leaf, and fruit is much lesser. On the other hand, Hanuman langurs, the leaf is much lesser than in the Nilgiri langurs, but fruit is significantly more. So this is the slide which shows simply the difference in what I've just showed here now. Now, this has a consequence. So the time budgets, if you see, for example, they spend a lot of time in feeding and resting, I showed you before. But here, you see the last slide, this thing here, social behavior. Hanuman langurs spend quite a bit of time in social activities. Nilgiri langurs, on the other hand, have very little amount of time in social activities. I mean, they are very much unlike primates. Most of the primates are highly social. You see bonnet macaques around you. I mean, the infants are playing all the time. And, individual females, even males, they sit and groom each other. And a lot of social activity goes on. You hardly see any kind of social activity in Nilgiri langurs. And we made this inference that this is because of folivory. It is folivory because they eat so much of leaf. They have to simply sit. They have to ingest it. And then they have to sit and simply rest and sleep for ingestion of leaf. And they have very little time available for social behavior. And that's what we called, like, you know, the title of this study itself was Folivory is a constraint on social behavior on Nilgiri langurs. So this is, males are hardly social. You see the females in Hanuman langurs are much more social than in Nilgiri langurs. And then we also compared the reproductive output of Nilgiri langurs with the Hanuman langurs. Now, these data were collected from different forest types. You know, this sampling we did in several places, in rainforests, in deciduous forests, in moist forests. We did this in two species of Hanuman langur, that is Hypoleucos and Priam, and compared it with the Nilgiri langurs. You know, how much is their output, reproductive output? This is the number of groups that I can just skip. But look at this, their comparative demography. This is S prime. This is, from Nagavali downwards. This is found only in the dry forests. And one female to 1.2 immatures. In another Hanuman langur, Hypoleucos, one female to one immature in the groups. And on the other hand, Nilgiri langurs is only one female to 0.4. So you see that, as compared to Hanuman langurs here, the reproductive output in Nilgiri langurs is very, very low. It's almost even less than half. And if you compare the wet forests and dry forests, put all together, in wet forests, the reproductive output is much lesser than in the dry forests. Now, since the Nilgiri langurs are more in the wet forests, so Nilgiri langurs' overall reproductive output is much, much lesser than those of Hanuman langurs. This is another behavior which is very interesting about langurs as such. Ajit, how much more time I have? Hello? Can I continue? Okay. You know, this is an interesting behavior which is seen in, which was reported in Hanuman Langurs by Sugiyama in 1960s, which is called infanticide. You know, as I told you, that most of the langurs, whether Hanuman Langurs or Nilgiri Langurs, they are unimale groups. You have just one male and females, and there are all male bands. Occasionally, what happens is that some male, mostly single male, will come from the male band and attacks the male in the female group, the single male. The fight can last, you know, days together sometimes, and most of the times these are bloody fights. You know, one of the animal would be badly injured. If the intruder is badly injured, the intruder goes back, leaves the forest, and you know, goes back to the male band, leaves the group. But if the resident male is defeated, the resident male leaves the group and becomes mostly what is known as a social isolatee, moves around alone. But this new male takes over, and something horrible happens in you know, in the langurs, that many infants die, which is known as infanticide. That this new male which comes and it kills infants, which are, you know, produced by the previous male. There have been several theories about this called social pathology hypothesis. Means, you know, that this is a pathological behavior. But Sarah Blaffer Hardy, who did her PhD on Hanuman langurs at Mount Abu, she first time actually talked about that this is actually a reproductive strategy. You see, this male's hormonal titers are very high. The females, if they have the young ones, their attention is towards the young ones, and they are not receptive to the male. So these infants probably just get targeted by the new male. There doesn't seem to be any kind of conscious killing of these infants. In the process, many of these infants die. And what happens as a consequence, that when the infants die, the females become, as long as they are like lactating, they won't be sexually receptive. So when the infants die, now this is a simple reinforcement again, that the females would become sexually receptive and the new male reproduces. So this becomes even, you know, subject to the action of natural selection, that the behavior would probably get reinforced, would get selected for. So as a reproductive strategy, this is repeatedly you know, reported in Hanuman langurs. We have reported this in recent macaques. We have reported in bonnet macaques also. We have occasionally seen it happening in line-tailed macaques, but there has been a rare incidence in Nilgiri langurs. And Kavana, when she was doing her PhD, she observed this in our study group in Nelliyampathy Hills in Kerala. There was a bisexual group and there was a close by an all-male band. You know, she divided this, you know, there was, you know, a raid by a male, and the resident male was defeated. So there was an infanticide. Two infants were injured and they were found dead. So what she did was that she had the duration before, you know, some long period, and then a couple of months, May to July, when the new male had come, and after that, which is the new male was there. So simply to say that before infanticide, during that infanticide event, and after. So when the male came, the resident male left with three juveniles and joined the male band. But this new male came and two infants, nobody actually has seen directly infant killing. So two infants were found injured and they were found dead. And one female also left the group, which is again a rare event, female dispersal. And the group also shifted to a poor quality habitat. And the next breeding season, there were two new infants which born to a new male. So this is one of those rare events of infanticide reported in Nilgiri langurs. And most of the behaviors were not affected, but social behavior during that those 3 or 4 months was severely affected. That the social activity was much, much lesser when the, you know, new male raided this. Now, the last part of my talk is about, you know, the threats and conservation issues. Nilgiri langur is still hunted in many places. There are several communities which eat the Nilgiri langurs for, you know, as food, and many of them hunted for medicinal purposes also, which is, of course, you know, it has no medicinal value, but this is what people believe. Habitat loss is one, and, you know, biotic effects is another, and habitat fragmentation is the main threat. Let me just briefly talk about this. This was a study done by Wesley Sundar Raj. It's just look at the graph again, not much to see it, except see where there is high disturbance and medium disturbance, the birth rate in Nilgiri langurs is much, much lesser than where there is a less disturbance. You see 0.66, no, 0.7 is the normal birth rate, for example. So 0.66 is the normal birth rate. And this is significantly lesser in areas which are disturbed. Likewise, the death rate, where there is the disturbance is very low, is about 0.25. That's the normal death rate. But medium and where there is a high disturbance, the death rate is very high. So the disturbed regions, you see, for example, there is a lesser birth rate, but high death rate. In several places, it has resulted in local extinction of populations. And this was the forest fragments, a thorough study conducted by Umapati and Prabhakar and Ajit Kumar. Prabhakar did on rodents and Umapati did on squirrels and primates. And Nilgiri langur was one of the study subjects for Umapati. Now, in the Valpare Plateau, in fragments, the 25 forest fragments, Nilgiri langur was absent in 6 of them. And actually, the lion-tailed macaque was absent in many more. But see, the fragments which was more than 100 hectares, all fragments had Nilgiri langurs. Now, these are forest fragments which are mostly privately owned. They are just located inside the tea estates. Some are natural fragments. Some are inside the sanctuary. But many of them are located inside the private tea estates. So, Umapati looked at all these. The medium-sized fragments, about 80% were inhabited by Nilgiri langurs, and small fragments, only about 55% were inhabited by Nilgiri langurs. And he found two things important there, that one was the predictor whether the Nilgiri langurs would be there or not, canopy height and tree density. So, more the canopy height, higher the tree density would determine or would be the predictor whether the Nilgiri langurs would be found or not, and also the habitat quality. That, the habitats where the quality was, habitat quality was more, there were more primates, including Nilgiri langurs and lion-tailed macaques. And Umapati also looked at parasitic analysis, which was very different than the data on lion-tailed macaques. I won't talk about it. But in Nilgiri langurs, they took data from 8 fragments. They found 13 parasite taxa. There was a high richness in areas which were more disturbed. Now, he had these fragments which were highly disturbed, medium disturbance, low disturbance, and he also considered fragment size, he also considered tree density, he also considered nearness to forest, for example. So, he considered several parameters. Most of the parameters did not affect the parasitic status, except the disturbance that were rare. High richness was found in disturbed fragments, but he also concluded that this indicates that the Nilgiri langurs actually can survive to a great extent in the disturbed landscapes. And there was this old study I found from Poirier in the 1960s. The shifting of a home range. Poirier was studying several groups, in one particular place. And in the range of one particular group, they started deforestation. They started cutting trees. Interestingly, the Nilgiri langur group wouldn't move out of that range, and they were quite reluctant to desert their home range, and they left the place only when the last tree was cut. Even when there were 3 or 4 trees left, they would go simply to some other place when the daytime, when the people were cutting trees, they would go to another forest patch close by, but night they would come back, and they left the place, final movement, only when the last tree was cut. So they're quite, loyal to their home range. And when they were shifting to the other groups, for example, in the daytime, there was a lot of aggression from what they call group B. And then they shifted to another place called group E, where they shifted to another place which was also disturbed. But what he concluded once again, like Umapati, the shift indicated that they have adaptability to survive even after human-induced disturbances. So, what is to be done about basically, because there is the fragmented rainforest. What I'm going to show you is something really fantastic. The work which is done by Nature Conservation Foundation Mysore. So whether it's lion-tailed macaques, whether it's flying squirrels, whether it's Nilgiri langurs or giant squirrels or many other terrestrial mammals. This work is again in the Annamalai Tiger Reserve in the Valpare Plateau, that the forest fragments require two things. One is enhancing the resource quality in the forest fragments, and second is link the forest fragments so that the animals can disperse between the fragments. In Valparaiso Plateau, Anita did her master's dissertation, and she simply looked around. How much is the distance between different fragments? You know, the streams and these little valleys, and she simply marked these areas, and she found that actually we require only 195 hectares land to most of these fragments can be connected, and all you require is 195 hectares. And because these are private lands, and shouldn't be much of a problem for Tamil Nadu government to buy 195 hectares of the private land. So these forest fragments can be linked. Now the next question is, to link them with what? With what kind of trees? Now these trees should be native to the Western Ghats, fast growth, and because these are coffee plantations, tea plantations, they should provide good shade. And they should also be trees which are the fruits of which are used by primates, by squirrels and by birds. This Nature Conservation Foundation, over years, they have been doing this restoration work. And this is only one list of species. And this is Shankar Raman from NCF Mysore gave me this list. But they have the whole list of species. And they started, this is one of the best field experiments of rainforest restoration in the world, I would say. They started in 2002. You can see this, a degraded patch given by Tata Estate. So they started this mixed species, restoration plantation there in 2002. The same place was like this in 2006, and same place is like this in 2015. The rainforest is completely regenerated. And you look at this, they published this paper in 2019. This is the benchmark Annamalai forest. This is the restoration site. Of course, you can never get back the natural forest. But a couple of more years, you can see, you won't be able to see any difference between the restoration site and the benchmark Annamalai forest. So this is one of those best experiments where they have shown that it is possible to regrow rainforest, number one. And the species which are native. And they did not even collect, pluck the seeds. They simply collected the seeds pollen. They simply walked around there in the, along the paths, which would have simply degenerated. They collected those seeds and started planting. So the point lesson over there is that these degraded habitats, they can be, the resource quality can be enhanced. We know now which kind of trees. And the same trees also can be now used to link these forest fragments. And the animal dispersal like lion-tailed macaques or Nilgiri langurs can be made possible. Two or three slides, Nilgiri langur has not been very successful in captive breeding. Like as I told you about most langurs are like this. This is Niloufar Begum wrote this stud book in 2015. She has given this historical data where all these animals have been. Now primarily they are, I'll come to where these populations are. So animals have been for, since 1972. So it's about 50 years or 40 years or so, these animals have been in captivity, but they have disappeared from many of the zoos in India. And this is red is Nilgiri langur. I mean, this is all different langurs. Red is Nilgiri langur. There have been about 80-85 total animals which are... historic population, and many of them are now captive born, and there have been few wild born animals. And this is the present population of this again red is the Nilgiri langurs. About 25 animals are there, few are wild born, but most of them are captive born. And this is the status of their breeding reproductive status. About 4% are in post reproductive phase. This world, we don't like these proven breeders, etc. These are, terms which should not be used. But anyway, these are the animals which have reproduced definitely or several times. And there are some young individuals and breeding age about 74% individuals. And largely, these animals are in RNR Anna Zoological Park in Vandalur. And they started this population from 1982. They brought four animals, one male and three females from Annamalai Tiger Reserve. The first birth was recorded in 91, and total births 49, 24 died, and 36 animals they have given to other zoos, and presently there are 18 animals in Vandalur. So if you look at the historical records, for example, the population size has been very low, the population growth has been very low, the record keeping also has not been very good. Actually, the births are not known, which parents actually have given the birth. And very few animals have been actually breeders. Most of the animals did not breed. And only one zoo has most of the births, as I told you. It's the Vandalur Zoo, which has maximum number of births. So what lot needs to be done as far as captive breeding is concerned. And just the day before yesterday only, we had a meeting, Vandalur Zoo, and I was a part of that meeting about captive breeding of Nilgiri langurs. We have worked out several strategies, because Nilgiri langurs and nine-tailed macaques and Nilgiri tar are the species which are to be captive bred in Vandalur Zoo. And this is the last slide. The title of this series of talks was very interesting. It's called Conservation to Coexistence. I mean, I would have liked the title to be Conservation and Coexistence. Let me share something a little bit about conservation to coexistence. This gives an idea as if, you know, we have been only conserving species or talking only about conservation. So conservation to coexistence would mean that probably in conservation areas also there should be coexistence. Last slide, let me talk about certain species are habitat specialists and certain species are habitat generalists. Certain species are obligatory forest dwellers. Certain species are largely commensal. By commensal, I mean that they can live along with human beings. Like for example, primarily forest dwellers, nine-tailed macaques, largely commensal, like the barn macaques, for example. Some species are intolerant of disturbance, and some species can mildly, you know, moderately tolerate disturbance. So coexistence is easily possible with species which are habitat generalists, species which are largely commensal, species which are tolerant. Now let me give you an example quickly from the Valpara Plateau once again. If you look at those forest fragments, for example, of the two primates, nine-tailed macaques are confined to forest fragments. They don't leave. I mean, there are, you know, probably 100 years, single fragment, one or two groups of nine-tailed macaques surviving there. The fragmentation has affected them much more than fragmentation has affected Nilgiri langurs. Because Nilgiri langurs sometimes can run on grasslands. They also can make use of trees, roadside trees, which are smaller trees, which nine-tailed macaques don't use. So, no, Nilgiri langurs can move between the forests. They are moving a little bit between the forest fragments. Lion-tailed macaques don't. So lion-tailed macaques require, you know, those inviolate forests, whereas Nilgiri langurs can tolerate some disturbance and have been moving. Likewise, squirrels, for example, the Indian giant squirrel, they can make use of these roadside trees. So Indian giant squirrels can disperse between the forest fragments, but the flying squirrels, you know, flying squirrel requires a tall tree. They have to glide. So flying squirrels are severely affected by forest fragmentation. Giant squirrels are not up to that extent. Lion-tailed macaques are affected, severely affected, but not Nilgiri langurs up to that extent. So when we talk of conservation to coexist with existence, we must keep in mind that it is possible for several species to coexist with humans. And I have been giving talks on in a totally different context, where I've been, you know, details talking about management of forest-dwelling species and largely commensal species, which is a different topic. But we must understand and keep in mind that inviolate forest habitats would continue to be required for conservation of several species, many of them being habitat specialists, many of them being, you know, obligatory forest dwellers. Even carnivores, for example, leopards are found in so many places, and they can actually, in Maharashtra, in so many places, they are largely commensal. In Rajasthan, in several places, they are existing with the people, tigers won't. So there are certain species where it's simply really not possible to say that conservation to coexistence. They require inviolate for forest habitats where coexistence is simply not possible, but several other species can coexist. And this was the last slide. No, this is just some slides, and this is actually in backwaters of Kabini. This is my wife, Mridula, and me there. This is in Akamarai grass hills. No, these are our colleagues. So many people used to come to our field station. This is Cornelia from Austria. She spent 7 years. And this is Werner Comments from Germany, our long-term collaborator, Kathleen DeFalco from USA. You know, many of the people have come here. For example, this is Matt Cooper. He did PhD on macaques in India. He did postdoctoral work with us on bonnet macaques, spent many years, has gone back to US and there he's a professor there. This is Sushma, this is Sharma, did PhD on long-term macaques. This is, as told you, Cornelia. This is Matt Cooper in Grass Hills. You know, we work in addition to these primates. We have been working in long-term macaques. This is, number of people who have worked on long-term macaques, on sympatric primates. Anand Kumar did PhD with me on elephants. We have been, doing work on long-tailed macaques in Nicobar Island for many years now, on large mammals, bonnet macaques, many people. Sanjay Molu did PhD on rodents and bats, on cylinder loris, Sindhu's PhD, Anna Nakari's PhD, Samita is doing now PhD. And, we only started the most detailed work on cylinder loris, and Kumara would be talking about this in tomorrow's talk. And new world monkeys, langurs, dogs, skinks, Indian giant squirrel, great apes. These are number of species of wild animals which we have been studying. I thank all these people. And also, thank you very much. And this is my email. And if we don't have much time for discussion, people can write to me and we will respond. Thank you. I have stopped sharing.
Yes. Sir?
Yeah.
We have questions from the viewers. Mr. Pavan NK is asking, what is the status of Nilgiri langur in South India?
I told you about roughly about 20,000. We estimate about 20,000 animals. They are quite in some places like Annamalai Tiger Reserve. It's a substantial, contiguous, large population. But in some other places, they are highly, fragmented populations. So the rough estimate is about 20,000 animals. But they're found only in, only in Karnataka, Kerala, and Tamil Nadu. Only in these three states because they are endemic to the Western Ghats region.
So thank you very much, sir. We are requesting our education officer to propose a formal vote of thanks.
On behalf of Mysuru Zoo, I thank Dr. Meva Singh for giving us insight on Nilgiri langur ecology and habitat. I thank Sri D.P. Ravi sir, Member Secretary, Zoo Authority of Karnataka, our Executive Director, Ajit Kulkarni, and CZA for giving us this opportunity, and all our viewers for making this program successful. I thank everyone.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.